12 minutes is how long a plastic bag is used, but can take up to, if not more than, 1,000 years to degrade in a landfill, which is where plastic usually ends up. They also end up in the oceans. In 2010, nearly 8 million tons of plastic entered the ocean, and it is estimated that there are about 100,000 tons on surface water. That's about the weight of 14,256 African elephants. This buildup of plastic waste in the ocean comes with many severe consequences, such as wildlife endangerment. Plastic debris damages ecosystem structures such as coral reef. The debris can cause abrasion, impact light penetration, and oxygen exchange. Plastic debris can trap, tangle, and constrict marine animals. It can also be ingested and have harmful effects on their health, such as reduced stomach capacity and metabolic disruption. Plastic debris not only harms wildlife, but it also affects us. For example, micro and nano particles are small enough to be ingested orally through water, marine products, cosmetics, and air. There have also been cases where exposure to chemicals from plastics, such as bisphenol A, are linked to an increased risk of breast and prostate cancer, birth defects, and endocrine and metabolic disruption. All this talk about plastic, but how did it come to be? Here is a brief history on plastic. Dating back to 1600 BC, the Mesoamericans first used natural rubber to make balls, figurines, and bands. In 1839, Edward Simmons discovers polystyrene. In 1862, Alexander Parkes created parkinsine, which is made from cellulose. In 1872, PVC was created by Eugene Baumann. In 1938, Roy Plunkett discovers polytetrafluoroethylene, commonly known as Teflon. In 1941, polyethylene terephthalate was patented and is one of the most common thermoplastic polymers used today. The global mass production of plastic began around World War II and has since generated about 8.3 billion metric tons. Of that, 6.3 billion metric tons of plastic became waste, and of the waste, 79% ended up in the landfills or natural environment. 12% was incinerated. And only 9% was recycled. This low percentage is usually due to high processing costs, contamination during sorting processes, and limitations on the number of times a plastic can be recycled without losing its quality. Another problem is that standard plastics are made from hydrocarbon monomers such as ethylene and styrene, which are directly derived from fossil fuels. How can we save the planet, our oceans, and ourselves? There needs to be a solution to plastic pollution, and soon. If no action is taken, it is estimated that the ocean will have 1 ton of plastic for every 5 ton of fish by 2025, and more plastic than fish in 2050. Today, the awareness of plastic pollution has led to a growing interest in biodegradable and biorenewable plastics. While biodegradable plastics have been synthesized, there are still a few drawbacks. For example, oil-based biodegradable plastic releases carbon dioxide during decomposition. If biodegradable plastics aren't disposed of properly and are mixed with regular plastics, they become contaminated. Biodegradable plastics are often labeled compostable, but because they require very specific conditions to degrade, they won't compost in your backyard. In fact, a study by the University of Plymouth showed that biodegradable plastics were still intact after 3 years of being buried in soil and in the marine environment.
Because of these concerns, further research into the development of new biodegradable plastics is essential towards reducing plastic pollution.
Howdy, I'm Crystal Chi, and I'm a rising senior at Texas A&M University, Kingsville. This summer, I'm working in the Michaudel Lab at Texas A&M University as a part of the NSF REU program.
My project focuses on the synthesis of biorenewable and biodegradable polymers from glucosamine. Biorenewable resources, sometimes referred to as biomass resources, are organic materials in which carbon is derived from a renewable resource via biological processes. In this case, we are using glucosamine, an amino sugar that can be produced by the hydrolysis of crustacean exoskeletons or by fermentation of corn and wheat. Our first step is to synthesize oxazoline monomers from glucosamine. The resulting monomer will be an inexpensive building block that is also non-toxic. We will then polymerize the oxazoline monomer via step growth polymerization to produce the desired biodegradable polymer. The toxicity, biodegradability, and mechanical properties of the polymer will be further examined. If you want to follow this project or know more about the Michaudel Lab, follow our Twitter and check out the website. Thank you for watching!